Hey, it's Rick McKague, Red Seal RV Tech for Voyager RV, and we're standing today on this beautiful sunny Okanagan day in our orientation delivery area. Today, we're going to be focusing on one aspect of my job, which is to provide you, the customer, with a full orientation of your unit upon delivery. If you miss or forget any details of your orientation, don't worry, we've got you covered. This orientation is going to be on a very popular Jayco Rocky Mountain Edition J-Flight. It's going to be specific to this trailer, but most of the points are going to apply to any RV. There's going to be a lot of information, but we're going to provide you with a list and a timestamp so that you can buzz ahead to the stuff that you're interested in seeing. So without further delay, let's dive into the first of three videos. So here we are on the interior of the RV, and the first thing we're going to talk about is the monitor panel. So here's the monitor panel right here. We have different scales for different things here. This red scale is for the battery, and the white scale is for the tanks. They each use these four lights up here. So when I press the battery, it's reading fully charged. That's low, fair, good, charged. So it's fully charged. The fresh tank is reading 1/3 full, black tank is empty, and the gray tank is empty. Down here we have the control for the water pump. To turn the water pump on, that's it. Now the unit is charged and there's water available throughout the trailer. To turn on the water heater on gas, that's all I do. Going to take a minute or a couple of seconds for the heater to light. Once it does, it'll stay lit until the water is hot, and then it automatically turns out. If by chance you don't have any propane flowing because you forgot to turn on the tanks, this fault light will come on. If that fault light comes on, you're locked out of all power to the hot water heater, whether it's electric or gas. To reset it, turn that off and back on. It looks like we have no problems and the unit is lit outside. So I'm going to test it on electric as well, and the only way you can test it is to, first of all, as we looked at outside, the water heater has water in it. Now I've turned on the element, so now the water will be heating. It takes about 20 minutes for the water to heat. So that's the basics of the monitor panel, and the next thing we're going to be talking about is the slide and awning controls. All right, in this instance, the slide room and the awning controls are pretty much self-explanatory. In and out for the slide room, so to bring the room in, you just go like that, you can hear it coming in, and to go out, just go like that until you hear that noise. That's all the way out, and that's when you take your finger off the button. For the awning, to let it out, you just press the button and out it comes. To bring it in, you just press the button and in it comes. Word of caution about awnings: you never leave them unattended. Even if you're only going away for 10 minutes, push the button and bring it in, because one gust of wind can cost several thousand dollars in damage between what's going on with the awning and what damage gets done to the roof when it gets blown up on the roof. So bring it in if you're not going to be around. On these light controls here, this one is for the LED light strip in the awning itself, and this one is for the interior lights for when you first come in. So moving right along now, we're going to move on to the stove and microwave area. The first thing I want to talk about is the converter. This is your converter down here. The main purpose of a converter is to change your shore power into 12 volt. When your converter is running, like it is right now, because we are plugged into shore power, all of the 12 volt in the trailer is being run by this little gizmo right here. Also inside of this is a really good battery charger. So while you're plugged into shore power, this will be monitoring the condition of your battery and giving the battery exactly what it needs. When your battery is fully charged, it'll give it a trickle. When it's really undercharged, it'll give it full power. Inside of here as well are all your 120 breakers and your 12 volt fuses for the entire trailer. There's a couple of other places that I've been showing you where power can trip. For example, the GFI plug, we'll get to that in a minute, and outside at the battery on the main fuse. So that's the converter. Here at the range, to turn on the elements or the burners, you just turn it the controls to high, hit the sparker, and boom, they're lit. Ooh, that's warm. Okay, this is the control for the oven. I'm gonna turn it to pilot, push and hold. What's happening when I'm pushing down is I'm opening up the flow of gas to the pilot. That's where we're going to next. Okay, so now I'm just gonna reach in and light the pilot, and boom, it's lit. So I have to hold that in for a few seconds just so that the heat from the pilot flame will heat up the thermocouple. The thermocouple produces electricity by heat, and it will eventually energize an electromagnet in here, and that will hold that valve open so you don't have to hold it anymore. Then to turn on the oven, you just select the temperature and the burner lights. All right, the microwave is a microwave just like any other microwave. The big thing in a trailer is you have to have shore power for the microwave to work. While you're traveling, you may want to remove the glass tray. They have been known to break. It's a rare occurrence, but it can happen. So 120 appliances, there's several in the trailer that you have to have shore power for it to work. First of all, the microwave. Next, the air conditioner. The third most likely suspect, culprit, whatever you want to say, is the receptacles. None of those will be powered without shore power. There's also a 120 element in your fridge. And as we've already demonstrated, there's also one in your hot water heater. Those are the main ones. Your TV is plugged into a receptacle, so obviously it needs shore power as well. Here's your refrigerator. This is the coldest part of your fridge. This is the warmest part of your fridge. To turn the fridge on and off and to use the controls, you just access this panel right here. Turn the fridge on, just press the power button until the light comes on. It's telling me right now that this is in auto mode and it's using electricity because we are plugged in. If we weren't plugged in, it would switch over to gas. To switch it over to gas, press the mode button. It's now on electricity only, and there it is on gas only. So after a few seconds, it'll light. I'm gonna put it back on auto and just leave it there. That's the best way to use your fridge. Just leave it on auto, let it decide what it wants to use for power. This particular fridge has five coolness settings. Five snowflakes is as cold as it gets. So to change that, you just press the temperature, and now it's on the warmest setting, only one snowflake. So what happens if you're on one snowflake and you're getting veggies freezing up? Okay, this is the warmest part of your fridge. This is where your veggie tray is. So you have it on the warmest setting, but the veggies are still freezing up. What you're gonna wanna do is to adjust the thermistor clip. This is the thermistor right here. Every absorption fridge has one. So if you want the fridge to run warmer, you're gonna slide this little gizmo down towards the warmer part of your fridge, and that will fool the fridge into running warmer than it thinks it really is. On the other hand, if you have it on the coldest setting and you're not getting any freezing up in the freezer here, so the ice isn't freezing, what you're going to do is slide the clip up towards the coldest part of your fridge, and that will fool your fridge into running colder. I'm going to leave this in about the middle. It's very sensitive. Only like a half an inch to 3/4 of an inch should make quite a difference in your fridge temperature. So that's the thermistor, and that's your ultimate control. Use your control here first to control your fridge. If you're not getting the result you want from using this, then go to the thermistor. I'm going to set this in the middle position, and we're just going to leave it right there. Back here at the rear bunks, the only thing I have to show you back here is how you access the valves to the back of your hot water heater for winterizing purposes. In this case, it will be by opening up this hatch, and there's the valves right down there. This is going to be different in every trailer. You can refer to that video that I did on winterizing for more information about that. In the bathroom, the way to use your toilet, in this case it's a foot flush. So what we're going to do to fill the bowl with water is we're just going to lightly press on the foot valve, and once you have enough water in there, all the way down will flush the toilet. The main purpose of showing you this is for when you want to charge your toilet with chemical. You're going to be putting the chemical into the toilet bowl, filling a bowl up with water like that, and then dumping it in, and you want to fill that bowl up twice. Shower head, you're going to set your temperature down here, and then you're going to turn on the water to the shower head. You have a 6 gallon water heater in your RV. However, you're not going to get 6 gallons of hot water, because as the hot water comes out the top of the unit, cold water comes into the bottom, and it's going to mix, and you're going to get about 4 gallons of hot water before you really start to notice a drop in temperature. So it's important that you practice water conservation in the shower. So once you have your temperature set, you're going to turn off you're going to get wet, then you're going to turn off the shower head, lather up, turn it back on, rinse off, and then turn it back off and hang it up, and the next person can come in and have a shower. Number one rule of camping, always take the first shower. In the ceiling of your bathroom, you're going to have this little fan. I call these fart fans. So what you're going to do is just open up the vent and turn on the switch. And that will evacuate the aromas from the interior of the bathroom. This is your GFI breaker. In this trailer, it's located in the bathroom, which is common. The GFI stands for ground fault interrupter. So if you have a wet receptacle and you try to plug something in, rather than you getting zapped, this is going to blow, and it'll blow by doing that. So when you see that little red light on, that means there's no power in any of these receptacles at the moment. So the way to reset that is just to hit the reset button, just like that, and now there's power again. So if you have no power in your 120 receptacles, check this first. This is the comfort control center for this particular unit. So to get this thing to turn on, you just hit the power button here and it illuminates. To scroll through the modes, you hit the mode button. It's the same thing as the power button. That's for the fan. That is for the air conditioning, and that's for the furnace. That's off. So we are going to scroll down to air conditioning, and we're going to set the temperature to 18 degrees Celsius. And after a few seconds, the air conditioner will come on. I'm going to just turn it off. One thing that I should tell you about this particular thermostat. This is a very common thermostat, this Dometic one, for like mid-level trailers. Every trailer is going to have a slightly different configuration as far as air conditioning and heating is concerned. Some have more than one zone, etc., etc. So to get the full information on your particular unit, look in your owner's manual and read the information about your thermostat. Here we are at the television. So television, again, is a 120 appliance. It's plugged in right down here. So you're gonna need shore power for this to work. So we'll just turn it on, and I've got a couple of things to show you that are a little more unique to RVs than to regular TVs. First of all, getting channels over the air and selecting through cable. So you're gonna wanna go to menu, Then we're going to switch over to the channel. On channel, you go down to air, and now going either way, left or right, will put us onto cable. We're going to leave it on air. And then we're going to go down to auto scan. On auto scan, come on, up you go. On auto scan, it's going to, we're just going to scan the channels, and this is going to go through every channel that's available, and it's going to find which RF frequencies, radio frequencies, are available to this TV. Once it's found everything that's available, it's going to save you time when you're scanning through the channels, because anything that it didn't find in the scan, it's going to skip over. So let's say you find 3 channels out of 99 when you do the scan. It's only going to go to those 3 when you're going up and down on your channel selector. Right now we found 1 channel. That's all that we're going to find in where we're located here. Now the purpose of an auto scan is to find all of the channels that are within range of the antenna. The booster increases the signal from the antenna to the TV, so you're not going to get any kind of a signal at all over the air unless you have the booster on. Conversely, you're not going to get any kind of signal at all if you're in a full service park and you're hooked up to park cable and you have that booster on, because it interferes too much with the coax signal. So let's just show you how to turn that booster on and off. This is your TV booster, your antenna booster right here. So there's a little button that I'm going to press with my thumb right here, and you're going to see that little green light go off. We're now off of the antenna and onto cable. So this is the way you want it. If you're at park cable, you want that booster off. If you're trying to get a signal over the antenna, you have to have that on. Just a quick word about detectors. This is your propane and carbon monoxide detector. You're always going to find these detectors lower to the floor line. It should be below the level of the bed height, because propane is heavier than air, so it has to rise up to get to this detector. This is hardwired directly to your battery, so this is one of the parasitic loads that is within your trailer that will eventually drain your battery if you don't do a battery disconnect or disconnect your battery when you're storing it for a long time. Here's your smoke detector. The big difference between the LPCO detector and the smoke detector is your smoke detector operates off of a 9-volt battery. So you're going to have to change that every year at the same time that you change the batteries in your household smoke detectors. This one is along the ceiling, because obviously smoke and heat will go along the ceiling if they happen to start a fire. This concludes our orientation video. The points I've covered in this video will apply to most RVs, but if you have a specific question relating to your RV, please leave a comment below the video. Whether you're new to the Voyager RV experience or a longtime returning customer, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and that way you can get the most out of our how-to video series as we dive deeper into the details of RV maintenance. So until next time, that's it. And remember, good maintenance leads to happy camping.